Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we are going to be discussing the Indian government's decision to ban 59 Chinese apps. Now this is being seen as a retaliatory measure following the recent tensions at the border between India and China, which peaked on June 15th, in which Indian soldiers were killed and there were casualties on the Chinese side as well. There's been a lot of discussion in India about what kind of steps the government will take. There's been a lot of jingoism in the media also. And right now, yesterday, we saw that this was a measure announced by the Indian government. We have Prabir Purkayastha to talk more about this. Prabir, so this is a bit of an unusual measure. It was kind of unexpected. There's been a huge campaign going on in India, of course, among certain sections of the right wing, saying that this is the time to boycott Chinese goods, which you can come to later maybe. But how do you see, especially the technical and technological implications of a move like this?
See, the argument seems to have been in Indian, at least policy-making circuits, that this does not affect our economy. It only affects some people. And who can do without the apps? So, you know, there's nothing critical about these apps. So, yes, people may be a little unhappy who use TikTok or other apps, but it has no economic implications for us. That seems to have been the consideration under which we have really banned the Chinese apps. Of course, we can talk about what are the possible Chinese responses later or about the larger geopolitical or the geostrategic context itself, including the border standoff, which certainly is by no means over. But the point very narrowly focused, if we want to ban Chinese apps, how do you do it? So effectively, what you do is say that all the ISPs should block certain sites where you might have to go if you have to use the app, like Facebook. Even if you use the app, you essentially go to Facebook. So if Facebook is blocked, then the app doesn't help you because you're either looking at others or you're trying to live stream yourself, both of which then uses the Facebook servers. So blocking TikTok servers effectively could have the same purpose, that you would actually not be then able to either see or publish on TikTok. So effectively, you get cut off from TikTok if all the ISPs block TikTok servers, which is, it seems to be the intention. The second is those apps, which are kind of standalone apps, say you want to use your phone camera to do certain things. Now, those once uploaded do not need connection back to a server. They work from your phone. So if you don't delete them, those apps will tend to be still there. But as other things happen, newer versions come, you will not be able to access them. Therefore, effectively, over a certain period, your apps may indeed be dead. But for the time being, it may have no impact that you don't access either the Google Play Store yourself for an update, or if you are using the apps, it doesn't really have an effect on you. The second thing that happens is, in this particular case, the Google Play Store or whichever other store you may use, you can use, for instance, the iOS store also, that any app that you download can be blocked by the government saying the Play Store, these apps will not be downloaded. And I presume that if you tell this to the major Play Stores, that they will accept this and they will not therefore allow, if an Indian IP, to access these kind of downloads. That I think is possible. So effectively serve notices on the Play Store. In this particular case, the Google Play Store being the most important one, and then also block the ISPs is probably, presumably, the next set of measures that will now come in what I call when you flesh out the order. Now you have passed an order, but you need to then put the skin, bones, and other things flesh into it. I presume that's what it will do. So effectively, all the Indian users of TikTok would then not be able to use TikTok. So TikTok is one of the most popular apps that are being used by particularly younger people in the world. It has one of the highest downloads amongst the apps, again, as I said, the global population, and particularly the young population who have adopted to TikTok, partly because of the much smaller segments it tends to use, much more. So you can see that there are certain kinds of Instagram, TikTok becoming more popular, particularly the younger people. So yes, it will ensure that we have the American Facebook, Instagram, and others who are going to rule the roost, including YouTube, who are going to rule the roost. And the Chinese companies will not have an ingress into the Indian market if this ban continues. So that's where the situation seems to be. I think we are going to see a set of measures how to flesh this ban out. Of course, young people will always find ways to get around this kind of internet bans, because as you know, internet allows a certain degree of flexibility and being able to bypass various things. Right. As you know, the US tried to stop WikiLeaks. Mm-hmm. They even took it out from the domain registry, but they still couldn't stop WikiLeaks from being available globally. So mm-hmm. I'm going to leave those longer time frame issues out. But it is true that TikTok as a major emerging player, which it is at the moment, and a certain set of other things will no longer be accessible in India if this ban continues.
So one of the concerns or points raised by many critics is the fact that the government has, of course, cited threats to security, threats to the integrity of Indian cyberspace, has pointed to the fact that data is being siphoned off to servers in countries outside India, which makes it kind of appear like this is, of course, a Chinese conspiracy. While we do know that the situation is that this is a global trend and almost every app does collect a huge amount of data, and the way it processes the data is actually shrouded in secrecy.
Well, as you know, data is the new, as Global Economic Forum said, World Economic Forum said, the new oil. And then they modified it later, saying it's more important than oil, because oil is finite, this is infinite. Okay. So global capital has been salivating on the issue of data as a commodity for quite some time. And data as a commodity not only comes from apps, it comes from websites you go to. They embed cookies on your device, whether it's a computer or a smartphone. And that's primary task of those cookies, which is essentially small bits of code which are embedded into your system, is to send data out. That's how Google knows you. Even if you don't log into Google, Google will immediately know that you are on live at the moment. So these are all the things that Facebook and Google do as a default. And this is how they have become really the big data monopolies in the world. Absolutely. So the Indian problem that we have created is we have siphoned out only China as a country, which is not allowed to do it. Only Chinese apps are not allowed to siphon data out of the country. All other apps can do that. All other apps or cookies or anything else that you have, including, of course, Microsoft. If you have Microsoft Windows or Microsoft, any other application software, of course, that sends data out. In fact, it says, I'll update your software, in the guise of which, of course, it also checks your software. It, in fact, checks whether you have a legal copy of that software or not. So, you know, if we say that all companies in the world are allowed to do it except Chinese companies, you have created a situation which in world trading terms would be called an exceptional statement. And in such an exceptional statement would require exceptional circumstances for it. So if you say it's because of a border clash that we are having, that we have introduced essentially sanctions on China, this would amount to a unilateral sanction on China and its data applications, in this case, the apps that we are talking about. I think this would be considered an exceptional step that India has taken in trade terms. And the fact that if we're so cautious about our data security, then why is it that this is not extended to other countries, other apps? That is the key problem we are going to get, that if it is not extended to other countries, this then comes under a security exception that we are taking, that we are in a condition of virtual, not exactly war, but a war-like scenario. And therefore, apprehension of our security breach from China is much higher. So you are taking in what in WTO terms is called the nuclear exception, that this is a complete exception that you are taking. And this then is not subject to any trade review. Of course, the WTO trade review mechanism is virtually dead for other reasons, which I'm not going into here, mainly because of the United States. But you are creating this principle that you can retaliate against China because of the border tensions on any count. That leaves China then open to retaliate against you on any other count as well. So it is in fact the start of a trade war. Now, earlier you had banned them from, you know, free entry of capital. You had said any capital that comes from India, from China, will need special sanction. This is again extended only to China. Then you have now introduced this specific thing. You are striking them off from various tenders, which are global tenders. So you are creating an exception, China exception, in your trade terms. So then the question that arises is, what will China do? And if you look at the terms of trade between India and China, the point is the Chinese trade, export trade, we are, I think, seventh in the list of countries, and we have 3% of their exports. For India, though our exports are much smaller than the Chinese exports to us, but as a fraction of our total exports, it is still larger than what we are as a fraction of China's exports. But we are 3% of China's total exports. China for us is roughly about 5.5% of our total exports, which means that if they decide not to take it, we will lose 5.5% of our exports, and China will lose roughly 3% of their export market. So this is the good, you know, what are the, how much damage you can inflict on each other. The point is, for us, China is still a big market. For China, we are still not such a big market. For China, the third largest export destination for India. So that is the other issue that is, that will come up. And if we look at the kind of exports we do to China, it is possibly much easier for China to switch those exports to other countries, import from other countries. While in India's case, they are exporting critical components to us, which are critical for a whole range of industries. For instance, Rajiv Bajaj has already said that we export, or, you know, two-wheelers in large numbers. That's 15,000 crores of two-wheelers which go out from India. We are the largest exporter in the world. We have beaten China in this area. But we need components. So 15,000 crore worth of exports need 1,000 crores of imports from China. And if those components are not available, then being able to source them from some other country is not only going to take time, we'll have to see whether they're available, because most of the components in certain sectors come from China. That's true for instance, our pharmaceutical APIs. A large number of APIs in the Indian market today come from China, and we are the biggest drug exporters in the world for the generic market. But the generic market exports depend on Chinese APIs. So it is not that, you know, it's going to be as easy as the Modi government seems to believe, that China will not retaliate except against our apps, that they will fight when Mahabharata time, the Dharma Yuddha, that the Rathi fights against Rathi, those who are on foot soldiers fight against foot soldiers. So that's not the kind of battle that we have started. We have started asymmetric response, because a border clash really led to a border standoff, and we are now converting it to a trade retaliation, which opens it out for other kinds of trade retaliations as well. So I think this is very, very uncharted territory which India is heading. It seems to me we are upping the ante because we want China to give us some concessions. We believe those concessions cannot be got through basically military means. I hope that both sides are clear that a military standoff should not lead to war. And if that is so, then what are the instruments at our disposal? So we seem to be taking the route not of negotiations and trying to solve this through bilateral discussion, maybe between President Xi and Prime Minister Modi. But we seem to believe that if we pile on the pressure, then we side with Americans and the NATO countries against China, then possibly they will start, you know, accepting what we are asking for and back down on the border. And backing down on the border is this seems to be the game plan, with trying to up the ante in various ways. Unfortunately, this is, even if it was a even playing field, which it is not in trade terms, even if it was an even playing field, it means I will inflict damage on you and I'll accept some damage because of that. That is cutting off both our noses, and it doesn't really help either India or China. So I will say, just as the border standoff doesn't help us, either of the countries, I don't think this new trade war, which we have initiated in this particular case, will not in the long term help us, unless Indian side believes that this is the only way to get a settlement out of China.
And we do have the example, of course, of the US attempts in the recent past, both of the trade war itself and in its context, the tech war against Huawei especially, which really does not seem to have paid off. After all, making all those aggressive moves, nothing much has changed as far as the Chinese strength in that sector is concerned. So that's probably a lesson for India too.
You know, a lot of it has got covered up because of the pandemic. So after all, the US today is in one of the worst case scenarios for the pandemic. Well, China seems to have come out of it. So China is at least internally recovering. Export markets are also at the moment quite weak for China, partly because no country at the moment is seeing an economy which is revving up in any sense. In fact, most countries have cut back heavily. Industrial production is down. Therefore, both exports and imports, both are down for all countries, or at least most countries. Given that, Chinese recovery will be largely geared for their internal market, and their export market at the moment is really down, as also the US, whatever they were exporting. Nobody's going to buy fancy aircraft and other goods at the moment. They'll stop it for a few months at least. So given that, I think the trade war, it's difficult to assess the state of the trade war with while the economy is in this condition. So in some sense, we have yet to assess how much damage each one has inflicted on the other. But it is very clear that the damage that United States thought they would inflict on China, which will bring China on its knees to the US, this is Trump's belief, that did not happen. And China has made very clear that even if they suffered the consequence of the trade war, that it does damage their economy, they are not going to give in. They are not going to succumb, because if they do, they accept the position of US preeminence, that whatever US says unilaterally will be accepted by everybody in the world, including China. That's a position they're not going to take. So I think India's, therefore, belief that through trade war, and we have much less clout in global economic terms than China or the United States has, therefore, to believe that we can do something which the US could not do or Mr. Trump could not do, in spite of all the bluff and bluster, I think that's a lesson for us, that that route does not seem to pay much dividend. And I think this level of jingoism is also part of it, is also due to the fact that we don't seem to know what to do. So I think the Modi principle, which has worked internally, internal politics, bluff, bluster, threat, you know, take it to the edge, and then people back down because they cannot really go to that level, particularly when you're a ruling government at the moment. So you have a lot of instruments of power. So this kind of attack tactic, you can see, if Rahul Gandhi makes a criticism, Sonia Gandhi makes a criticism, any opposition party makes a criticism, they really immediately start not answering the question raised, but what you did 50 years back, what you do 30 years back, what did you do 10 years back, and so on. So you get a start of name calling of a certain kind. So I think this kind of politics, which they have sort of grown up with, when it comes to international arena, I don't think it works that easily. But hey, we never know. Maybe the Chinese will say, look, we don't want to really get into a tangle with India at this point. Let's give them some concessions, and then maybe Mr. Modi will get some concession and declare it to be victory. The reality is the border standoff has largely issues related to the India's building up the border roads, infrastructure at the border. And China, after particularly the change of Ladakh status from a part of JNK to a union territory, they, and Mr. Shah's statement in parliament that we will take back Pakistan-occupied Kashmir as well as Akshay Chin. I think that, this is what M.K. Narayan, the National Security Advisor, the former NSA, has also said, that we did not seem to have factored this aspect, that China might misread the situation or read the situation that India is actually now posing a threat to the Tibet Xinjiang Road or the CPEP. And given this threat that they perceive, therefore they have started building up and capturing, I'm quoting here General Panang, capturing the strategic heights on the border. So this is the reason for it. Or it could be perception that India and China both are now looking at each other through strategic competition and building up on the border. Whatever may be the reason, the reality is that will China back down because TikTok has been stopped in the Indian market along with 58 other apps. But as you know, TikTok is the key, is the biggie in this case. And it is emerging in the world as one of the competitors of the other big app players. So will that happen? That's a question to really answer. My answer is, in strategic terms, no country backs down because you have stopped a particular product import or a particular export. And you will see that Chinese will probably retaliate, but they will retaliate at their own time or of their own choosing. So they will also not be silent to this. Already reports are there before this itself that China is slowing down its exports to India. So all of those things are now on the table. We'll have to see how they respond. But not a very happy situation. And it doesn't look like we want to negotiate. Both sides, one side, we don't know, want to negotiate the border crisis at the moment.
Thank you so much, Prabir, for talking to us. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching Newsclick. Thank you.